Good morning, everyone. I'd like to welcome everybody. Pretty cold morning, but we're all pretty active here this morning, so that's good. Like to welcome you. Be sure to check your bulletin inside and out. All kinds of neat things there and upcoming events coming. A couple of them, just make sure food pantry, toilet paper this month that Karen takes care of for us. Make sure and continue to bring those in. Make sure you check out the College Board back here. And poinsettias, make sure to see Anita. If you have there should be a sheet in your mailbox as well. So, and just an update, we took 167 shoe boxes over to Burr Oak Church. So thank you very much, everybody that helped with that. A little ticky there. So do we have any other announcements, anybody?
If you didn't bring your thank offering last week, we'll take your thank offering.
Yep. If you forgot to bring your thank offering last week, you can just place them up here today or over the next couple of weeks if you remember to bring your thank offering boxes. So any other announcements?
Fairfield Food Pantry and Clinton Benton Jackson Christian Education Association, which is Kids for Christ.
Any other announcements? Okay. Be sure as well to see the inside of your bulletin for prayer concerns and continue to lift those up in prayer. Do we have...
I have a praise. My cousin Jeff Fleckleitner has been on our prayer chain or prayer list here in the bulletin for, I don't know, a year. And I saw him yesterday at our family Thanksgiving and asked about how he was doing. And he said that prognosis is good. His body responded to all treatment. And so the doctors aren't saying that he's in remission or that the cancer is gone. But when his wife said, when you look at his second PET scan, the first one, he was just lit up. The cancer, prostate cancer, had spread to his ribs and pelvis and his wrists and was in his bones. And that is totally gone. She said his second PET scan showed none of that. He is doing well. He is just on hormone therapy because, you know, that's the prostate, whatever hormone was feeding that prostate and prostate cancer, that's gone. And so he's having other hormone therapy. But he is working. He works construction. He's doing all his lifting. He's doing everything. So thank you. That's a praise. So prayer works.
Amen. Just remember, continue to remember my brother Matt and his wife. I believe Matt goes in tomorrow for another treatment. So, and his wife had a knee replacement, and she's getting around pretty good. So need to get her back and healthy so she can begin her treatments as well. So any other prayer concerns or praises? Gavin's home. Hallelujah. How long is he home for? Next Sunday, so. If you want to see Gavin, just stop at Anita's or Grandma Ruby's. I'm sure he'll be at one of the two places all. And Grandma Linda, sorry, Grandma Linda. So, any other praises? Okay, if you would bow with me for a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day, and we thank you for the opportunity that you give us to be here today, and we thank you for the snow. The nice white covering across the landscape and just looks beautiful this time of year. We'd ask that all of these prayer concerns, that we lift each one of these up to you, that you would comfort and care for those in need, that you would answer their prayers in your time. We just ask that you would continue to be with each one of us as we have praises as well, and we thank you for answered prayers. Just ask that you would continue to be with our church family, those that are traveling or unable to be here today, that you would bring them back safely to us in the coming weeks. We ask all of this in your name. Amen. If the praise team would come forward, and please stand.
The Lord's blessing. He chastens and hastens His will to make known. The wicked oppressing now cease from distressing. Sing praises to His name. He forgets not His own. Beside us to guide us, our God, with us joining, ordaining, maintaining His kingdom divine. So from the beginning, the fight we were winning, Thou, Lord, with our side, all glory be Thine. Ye all do extol Thee, Thou leader triumphant, and pray that Thou still a defender wilt be. Let Thy congregation escape tribulation. Thy name be ever praised, O Lord, make us free.
Our scripture reading can be found on the flap in your bulletin if you want to read along from Psalms 101 through 5. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Would you please join me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
You may be seated. And if the kids want to come up, I'm sure Pastor Jeff's got something for you. And just as a reminder, if you need to get a family picture here today sometime or something, all of this is going to be leaving tomorrow. So Kate and her crew are going to take everything out. So if you need a family picture, make sure you get it done today.
Good morning, guys. How are you? Good. So, hey, Thanksgiving's coming this week. Do you know what we do on Thanksgiving? What do we do? What do you do on Thanksgiving?
Eat.
Eat. How many of you eat on Thanksgiving? Oh, yeah. Yeah. How many of you have stretchy pants? Yeah. Yeah. All right. Thanksgiving. But it's not all about eating. We have a dinner together and we gather with our families and we celebrate being thankful. So I'm going to ask you, I want you to think about this. I want to let you answer right away. I want you to tell me what you are really, really thankful for. Is there something that you're really thankful for? And I'll let somebody here in the congregation help answer that question so you understand what I'm asking for. Can anybody tell me what they're really, really thankful for? Anybody? Good health. That's a good one. Amen to that, sister. Good family. Oh, yeah. Praise the Lord. Somebody else? What? Snow. I don't know. We had like nice weather, nice weather, nice weather, then boom. Like, oh, now I remember what I don't like about living in Indiana. And not only did we get snow, it was horribly cold. Has anybody been out in the horrible cold? Actually, I drove Thursday. Was it Thursday that we got it? I had to go out to the VA Thursday, and there were so many cars like way off the road. And I'm like, this is Indiana. People should know how to drive. And I mean, like, way off the road. I'm like, how did you even get there? You know? All right. So, that has nothing to do with being thankful. So, have you been thinking about what you're thankful for? You have? Okay. Well, you look like you're ready. Can you tell us what you're really thankful for?
God.
Oh, yeah. I am very thankful for God. He spoils me. He treats me so, so good. Somebody else, what are you thankful for?
Food.
Oh, yeah, I do love to eat. Anybody love to eat? I was just talking to Jack. I won't embarrass Jack because he doesn't eat very much, but that's not true. Jack and I agreed we're meat and potato guys. You know, I love meat. I could eat meat every day. Who could eat meat every day? Yeah, every meal. Who could eat vegetables every meal? Yeah, well, we're going to pray for you guys later. All right. So I am thankful for food. Probably, sadly, you know, we don't. There are places in the world where they don't have a meal every day. They don't eat regularly, or they have one meal a day, or they eat every other day, which is really kind of sad. We throw away so much food. So when your mom and dad give you a plate of food, you have to eat how much of it? All of it. Even the vegetables? Yeah. No? I think Jen made Brussels sprouts the other day. She said something that was not a mystery to me. She said, these Brussels sprouts aren't very good. I'm like, that's right. That was true before you cooked them. It's still true. All right. I didn't eat Brussels sprouts, by the way. What did I have? Yeah, okay. Pork cutlets. All right. What about you? What are you thankful for, little man?
I'm dinosaur toy.
For your toy? What kind of toy?
A dinosaur toy.
A dinosaur toy. What's your favorite dinosaur?
Dinosaur toy.
Dinosaur toy. Yeah. I remember when dinosaur toys roamed the earth. Okay. All right. What about you there, big guy? You want me to? I think he's trying to ignore me. What are you thankful for?
My dad.
For your dad? That's awesome. Yeah, you know what? I was just reading Exodus 20, and I don't know if you guys are familiar what's in Exodus 20. It's the Ten Commandments. Does anybody know what the fifth commandment is?
Praise your mother and father. Well, like, respect your mother and father.
Bam! She is on the money. That is. That's number five. Honor your mother and father. And it actually says, if you do, you're going to have a long life. So respect mom and dad. Okay? That's excellent. Well done. I am thankful for my mom and dad. What else? What about you over here? You've been awfully quiet. What are you thankful for?
Family.
Family. Yeah, it's nice to get together with family, right? Except that one cousin or uncle or aunt. Everybody has one. You know what? In my family, it's me. No, I'm kidding. All right. Did you say what you're thankful for, sweetie? Are you nervous? A little bit? All right. Do you want to say what you're thankful for, big guy? No? Okay. Well, hey, we're going to be celebrating Thanksgiving, and I'm going to be talking about being thankful today in looking at all the offerings. But let's revisit this verse here from Psalm 100, because this is a great psalm. And it says this, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness before him, with joyful songs." Would anybody like to sing a song to the Lord? I'll tell you what, I'll make it easy. Could we shout for joy? So it would probably look something like this, like, "Go, God!" Actually, how many of you watched did any of you watch the Notre Dame game yesterday? How did Indiana fare yesterday? How about Purdue? Well, praise the Lord. All right. So have you ever been to a ball game? Have you ever got excited? Oh, wait a minute. Did anybody see the end of the Buffalo Bills-Minnesota Viking game last week? I about lost my mind. That's what I'm talking about. When we come into the house of the Lord, being that kind of excited. So let's just say, "Go, God, we love you," as loud as we can. Are you ready? We're going to do it on three. Wait, let's practice. Say, "Go, God." Okay. We'll say, "Go, God, you rock." All right, ready? On three. Are you counting? I'm going to count. Are you ready? One, two, three. "Go, God, you rock." Now, does that sound weird in church? Yeah. That's because I don't know why that's like that, because it shouldn't be like that. Thank you, guys. Take some candy. Go sit down. You get two because you got the fifth commandment. That's awesome. Thank you. in your Bible reading, when you get to Leviticus, you're like, oh, it's Leviticus. Oh. But we're gonna take a look at the sacrifices in Leviticus this Thanksgiving. And I want to assure you, I have never studied harder than I have this week in this particular study. Because this is what the Lord laid on my heart. You know, how do we express an attitude or how we feel about how grateful we are to God? And so actually, part of you being here, just being here, is doing that. You're saying, God, I appreciate and I value the things that you have done and you are doing for me. And so in Israel, they had a number of prescribed sacrifices. And Leviticus 1 through, I don't know, maybe the first 6 or 7 chapters, talks about them in detail. I'm not going to run through all the stuff that's in there necessarily, but to help us understand why God instituted those in the lives or the nation of Israel as a practice. And I believe they have to do with being thankful, with offering thanksgiving. I think sometimes when we come to church, we do church stuff and we forget that we're actually trying to focus our attention on saying, go God, you rock, you're awesome. You know, in my prayer time, because I've been writing them, I kind of now have this habit. The first thing I say is, good morning, Lord. And hey, thanks I got through the night, you know, or thanks for another day. You know, it's like, how can I go on without just saying thank you for, you know, another day? I'm grateful for that. And here I am at church, and I love coming to church. When I was a pastor before, I hated Sundays. It sounds horrible, but I did, because they were filled with anxiety and chaos and nonsense. And coming here, it's not like that. It's for me, it's refreshing. It's I feel like maybe the temperature here, and this has to do with the people, is it feels good. You know, have you ever been around people that you're like, I want to be around those people? You know, but you've been around people, you're like, I got to get out of this crowd. These guys are, it's like being in a bowling alley. Why are we here? You've got to leave. No offense to those who bowl, but what a sport. I heard once it was like the sport of kings. Bad kings. That's weird. All right, so let's talk about the offerings. And the first offering in Leviticus is described as the burnt offering. And what I'm going to do for you, I'm not going to read all that, but I'm going to tell you what sets the burnt offering apart. And here's the other thing, which isn't necessarily implied in the passage. We read this. We read all 6 of these offerings, or 5 of these offerings, the burnt offering, the peace offering, the fellowship offering, the sin offering, and the, there's one more, the guilt offering. And we're like, man, this is crazy. How does this all play out? But the truth is, whenever, if I were to read through the Pentateuch, let's just stick to the Pentateuch, because it was considered the law or the Torah, how they understood how to exercise their faith, it would have prescribed times that we came to Jerusalem to offer an offering. So it wasn't like all the time. It was at special times. And so we come to church, what, every Sunday? And then there's a few special occasions. And when we come, there's this idea that we're going to do this offering. Have you ever been in a church? First time I saw it, I was like, that is the coolest thing. But we don't do it here. And I remember I went to a church, and I think it was probably a black church. We were down probably helping with Katrina right after the hurricane. And we went to this church, and they had this fantastic choir. They sang forever. They preached for maybe 40 minutes. We were there for a couple hours. But when they did the offering, everybody got up out of the pews, and they played music, and they came up celebrating and dancing, and then they put their money in the box at the front. And I thought, well, that was interesting. It was different. I mean, it wasn't like, hey, you know, we want to embarrass anybody who doesn't give. It wasn't like that. It was like this celebratory, oh, we're so grateful and we want to give to God. And so when I think of these offerings, I think of that. They were coming to Jerusalem and they were taking the best of their flock. In all the offerings, especially the burnt offering, what makes it unique, it had to be a male and it had to be the best. It had to be without defect. It had to be a male. It was spotless, without defect. And they would bring it when they came for the festivals or the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, or any of the other festivals, or even at a special time. And they would bring this animal. And I don't raise animals, but I'm trying to think, if I brought the best of what I had, it'd probably be one of my cats, which would be totally horrible. Wouldn't want to do that, but that would be hard to do. And so I was just telling Rick, we just bought a half a cow that we're going to eat, and I'm so happy about that. But I can't imagine if you had to bring a cow today. Well, I don't know what a cow costs. And you had to bring a cow and offer it. And what you did is you brought it and you put your hand on it, and you were symbolically saying, this animal is going to take my place, and this animal was killed. And it was cut up in a very specific way if we read the passage. But the blood was sprinkled on the altar. And the one thing that's unique about the burnt offering, among all the other offerings, it was completely consumed by fire. Nobody ate any part of it. The only thing that went to the priest was the hide, but everything was burned. And so I was doing a study of this particular section, and here's what blows me away. When it talks about makes atonement for themselves, and that's kind of what the offering is doing, but it's not doing what you think it's doing. You think that by making that offering, they're in some way doing something that's making them right before God, and that's not actually what's being implied here. Kippurith has this idea of getting God's attention by showing your gratitude. And so I had to go back, and I saw the word used in relation to Jacob. Jacob uses this term when he's getting ready to face Esau. And what he does is he sends all these things ahead of himself so that Esau will be less and less wanting to kill him when he sees Esau again after stealing the blessing and running away. And so Kippurith has this idea of meaning this. It means wiping his face clean. In other words, eliminating the wrath that exists between him and his brother. That's what he was doing. He was offering gifts to make his disposition different. That's in essence what the language is implying about the burnt offering. We are asking God to change in his disposition towards us. And so we know that if we're sinful and we're in the presence of mighty God, we would be destroyed because sin and God can't coexist. If you were to read Exodus, when they get to Sinai, God's like, don't let them come up on the mountain. It will be very bad for them. And so that's what's happening. We bring this offering, and we're doing it in such a way that we want to change how God feels about us. And nobody does that like Jesus does that. You understand? Jesus has, this is a weird word, has completely assuaged the wrath of God. It's gone. It doesn't exist. We have applied that blood to the door of our lives, if you will, and there's no animosity between us and God. And that's what that sacrifice did. And so I would assume probably if I was an Israelite, I brought that maybe once or twice a year, which would be a big deal because that if I was a herdsman or whatever, that's the best of my flock. I'm taking the thing that is the most value that I have and I am presenting it to God to change his attitude towards me. And I want you to think about that for a second as we come into the house of the Lord. When we come into the house of the Lord, I know sometimes we think small C church. You know, we got to do our church routine stuff. When we come to church, what can we do that puts a smile on God's face? What can we do that, in other words, wipes his face clean? And again, Jesus has done that, but how can we get God's attention that he would put his focus on us? I want you to think, parents, about your children for a second. Have your children ever done something that put a smile on your face? I mean, we know they've done stuff where you'd be like, oh, are you kidding me? But have they ever done stuff that you were like, oh, wow? You know, when the grandkids came over last night, we got to watch Blue for the first time. How old is Blue? 6 months. That's crazy. Fortunately, it went well. He didn't get cranky till right there at the end. The last half hour was a lot of work. A lot of bouncing, a lot of crying. But I remember when little Wilder came in, he had on like this little Carhartt hat, had his hands in his pockets, and Wilder's what? Two. He's just, and I'm like, that's the cutest thing I've ever seen. It literally, you could eat that up. It's just so cute. It's just pure cuteness. And how do we do that? How do we make an offering in such a way that God is just, I want to bless the heart of God. I do. And I know I have Jesus. I'm banking on Jesus. But aside from that, how can I, as his child, put a smile on his face? Have you ever thought about that? How can I make God happy? How can I please him? What do I got to do? And that's what the burnt offering was. And so there were these two really important offerings, and the burnt offering was probably the most important, and the second is the grain offering. And the grain offering kind of blew my mind a little bit. I'm going to take you to Exodus real quick. If you would turn to Exodus chapter 12, and again, I love it how in my own reading, God is teaching me things in relation to the messages he wants me to bring. And so this is what it looked like the day after Passover. So if the burnt offering, and again, all the offerings, let me just explain this, are just a picture of what Jesus has done. They're symbols. They have meaning, but they're also symbols of things that are going to happen later. And so we know in the Exodus that the angel of death passed over everybody that put blood on their door. And so a male, was killed, and they ate it, and they put the blood on the door, and then the angel passed over. But the next day, this is what happened. I'm going to start in verse 33. This is as they were leaving. The Egyptians urged the people to hurry and leave the country, for otherwise they said, we're all going to die. We've had enough. Plague after plague after plague after plague. And now the firstborn of every family, the firstborn of every animal, of all livestock, everything died where the blood was not applied. And the Israelites did as Moses instructed. Oh, I'm sorry. I need to read 34. So the people took their dough before the yeast was added and carried it on their shoulders in kneading troughs wrapped in clothing. I'm like, I'm reading that and I'm like, why does that matter? If I had to leave my house, and we don't live out west, so we're not in fear of forest fires, right? But they do. And sometimes when it happens, they got to go. I don't know if you've ever been in a situation where you've been somewhere and you had to go. You had to leave now. And again, we talked about, I think the one little girl says, I like food, or I'm thankful for food. These guys took their food, wrapped it in their clothing, put it on their shoulder, and carried it out of their houses. And that was one of the things that they did when they left. And they did it so fast that there was no yeast in it. Then it says it again. It doesn't just say it once. If you skip down with me to verse 39, with the dough they had brought from Egypt, they baked cakes of unleavened bread. The dough was without yeast because they had been driven out of Egypt and did not have time to prepare food for themselves. So quickly was their exit that they took what they had and they made bread without yeast. And so it mentions it twice in the text. And so when I get to this grain offering, it starts to make some sense. Because if you read what's unique about the grain offering, it's a memorial. It's the only place it says it among all the offerings. It's a memorial. What's a memorial? It's something that we see, we do, or we make so that we can remember. And what are they remembering? They're remembering that they were delivered from bondage. What kind of bondage? They were slaves. They were in forced labor. They were being controlled and manipulated. There was a particular kind of genocide because they didn't want them to grow out of control, so they were killing the little boys. This was the environment that they were rescued from. And when they were rescued, they had to leave stuff behind, and they only took the stuff that they thought was important, and it was this bread. And they couldn't put any yeast in it. And it's this memorial. And so this is the second offering. And here's what's unique about it. It was fine flour. You poured some oil in it, and you mixed it with some incense. And if you read in the Hebrew, the incense actually is frankincense, which is this incense that God said was the only incense, the only fragrant incense that could be used in temple worship, frankincense. I was watching Toy Story last night. How many have seen Toy Story? Where little soldiers go out, and I think it's at the very end of the movie, and the soldier's like, frankincense, this is myrrh. You know, that was cute. All right. Anyways, so they mixed it, and they could make cakes out of it, but the priest would take a portion of it and throw it on the altar of burnt offering, and then the priest would keep the rest of it, and they would eat it, and it was very, very holy. And it says that it's a memorial. And I got to thinking about that in light of their exit. I don't know about you. There are many things in my life that are memorials for me that remind me about what God has done. And they're special. I'm standing in this church, and some of these things are important to you that I don't know how important they are. I remember one time moving that picture, and it was important to people. I'll bet you some of you can tell me, you know, how important the stained glass is, how important that cross is, you know, why we do this stuff. Some things have a lot of meaning. We see them or we experience them, and things are brought to mind. We're reminded, which creates an attitude of thanksgiving. I think I've shared this. I have been to the wall in Washington, D.C., and that was very meaningful. Actually, all of the World War II, the Korean War, all the memorials are very meaningful to me. And so there are things. And God's like, every time you come together, and I'll bet every time Israelites came back, if they didn't offer a burnt offering, I'll bet you they brought this, because this was actually considered their tithe. If you read the Hebrew in its context, it talks about it was their regular offering. It was their tithe. It's something that they gave on a regular basis. And they did it because they were thankful. They did it because it seemed right. I want to be, I pray about this, I want to be a great tither. I want to have my ducks in a row so that I can give to the Lord. And not only give to the Lord, but give to others so that I could be more generous. And so I pray about those things because I don't think our culture teaches that. Now, I don't believe that's true here at this church, because even during COVID, nothing really changed fiscally. People are generous. I know the leadership of this church. If there was somebody in this congregation or even in this community, and we've done it even outside of this community. I remember we had some friends. Actually, it was Eric Hex. He was a police officer that was killed in the line of duty. His wife moved to Syracuse. She married that husband that she married. He died of a heart attack, cancer. And did her third husband die? No. They had a fire that completely devastated their whole house. And we found out, and this church helped them. The generosity with which this church easily gives away money. My favorite memory is when I was just visiting this church. I wasn't even being considered. And I remember a stranger had walked in the back door, and you guys were like talking about, I think you might have given them the offering or a portion of the offering. I may be exaggerating. I was a visitor. That's how I perceived it in my mind. They gave them the offering. That's crazy. That's the culture of this church. But as individuals, whenever we come, Do we have something to give? Are we generous? Are we? And so let me take a second just to say this. So the thank offering, there's a lot of new faces. And I forget about it. The thank offering is tied to the Operation Christmas Shoebox. It helps cover the postage. So 167 boxes, the postage was like $1,300, which isn't a big deal. But what the church has done historically is you got these little banks, and through the year, you put change in it. And then at the Operation Christmas Shoebox, we bring the change in. And then I would assume Ruby's the one that counts all the change, goes towards the offering. And I don't want that to stop, but I want to do a better job of communicating that to us, that in addition to the things that we're giving, that you have a chance to take this loose change and do something with it at the end of the year. Help send these boxes to these children. And trust me, some of those boxes are going to make a profound difference in the life of those kids. And you know, with both sacrifices, the outcome was it was an aroma pleasing to the Lord. Now, I love meat. I know when somebody's cooking out. Man, God knows. Is our offering an aroma that's pleasing to the Lord? Because we look at these things, we don't do these things anymore. But we should. Maybe not literally, but we should symbolically. Because as the one little girl said, who are we thankful? Why are we thankful? For God. For God. For all the good things that He does. If you don't know that God is doing good things, you need to spend a day in reflection and think about the way that God is meeting your needs, the way that God is caring for you, the way that God is helping you. Because He is. If you're His child, He's invested in you, in me. And we should be grateful for that. You know what? You answer this question. Do you think in our culture today that we have a lot of people that have an attitude of gratefulness? I wish it was more common. It seems like it's more uncommon. We're more angry. We're waiting in line. I'm not going to lie. We're at Walmart, waiting in line. It's hard to be grateful at Walmart, waiting in line. But what's God's desire for us? An attitude of thankfulness. Or how about when things don't go your way? You know, it's easy to be thankful when we're in a good mood. Life doesn't necessarily create good moods all the time. How about when you've coached a football game and you lose? It's hard to have a good attitude, you know, sometimes. You know, the favorite thing, there's a lot of stuff the media is not showing you. And I don't care how you feel about the NFL. The Vikings are going to win it all. But if you watch, some of the believers will get together after the game and they're praying together when they just did battle on the field. I remember my favorite memory at ECA wasn't ECA praying with Fairfield. It was Fairfield asking to pray with ECA. Those are the things that just, you know, and my point simply is this. What if we had a constant attitude of thankfulness? Isn't that a verse, actually? Rejoice always, and in everything give thanks. Here's the last three of these sacrifices, and I want to mention them. And the next one is the fellowship, and actually it should probably be translated peace offering. And what it is this offering that you give that actually is a meal that you partake in with the priests in the holy place. And the symbol is I have peace with God, and we're having communion. We're in relationship. We actually do that now, right? It's called communion, where we prepare our hearts and we take of this symbolic meal. And really, it's not just that I have peace with God. We have peace with each other. I have learned over and over and over and over, if I have strife with anybody, usually it's that person that I have to wash their feet, or they have to wash my feet, because we were brother and we did it the weird way. And, you know, But that's just the way it works. You know, God always tends to put that person in front of us that we've got to work something out. We've got to say, I'm sorry, or we've got to ask forgiveness. And so there's this peace offering. And what was unique of the peace offering was it could be male or female. And the cool thing about, if you read the text in Leviticus, depending on your, with the exception of the burnt offering, it could be a bull or a lamb, and it progressively went down. So if you were really poor, it could be two doves or two pigeons. God made a way. God made a way for anybody who felt that they needed to do this, that they could do that. And so it was without defect. They still laid their hands on it. The blood was sprinkled on the altar. The meat was shared. And so it was this fellowship offering that we did together. And we're doing that right now. We're fellowshipping together. We're coming together not just so that we can say, thank you, God, but that we can enjoy each other's company. And I do. I enjoy your company. The last two, the sin offering and the guilt offering, are unique. And so I want you to understand them. So I think it's easy when we read Leviticus, we read all these offerings and we assume this. They had to do this all the time. No, it's not what you think. It's probably not unlike our experience now. When we come to dedicate the Operation Christmas Child boxes, we bring our thank offering. When at Easter, looks a little different than it does Christmas Eve. There are things that we do different at different times. But if this happened, this is the sin offering. When I sin unintentionally, in other words, I did a sin of omission. I did something that I didn't realize was sinful, and then later on, I'm thinking, you know what? I may have actually offended somebody, or I offended God, or I did something. Now that I know, what do? I can take this offering, and I'll go to Jerusalem, and I'll make this right. That's something I can do. I remember the day that I went, it was a Wednesday night, I ran to church and I begged God to forgive me and I rededicated my life. I think it was that moment. And it was just kind of like, you know what? I was living like a pig and now I don't want to live like a pig anymore. I want to be different. I realized, you know, that, you know, and we weren't married yet probably, or we weren't. And she had little boys. And I'm like, we can't live like this anymore. It's not good for the kids. We got to change. And I ran to the church and begged God to change me, and he did. And I think it's like that. And I'm going to be honest with you. There are people who do bad things, and it doesn't bother them that they do bad things. I heard a story recently where somebody cleared out all of the lost and found stuff, stole it and took it home. And then a camera caught them, and they called them and said, hey, did you do this? And they lied about it. And it reminds me, there are people who do things, and it doesn't bother them that they do those things. Do you understand what I'm saying? And that's grieving the Holy Spirit, so to speak. That's just saying, I can hurt you, and it doesn't bother me that I hurt you. I remember one Sunday calling the elders in and said, hey, listen, I was in a fight with my wife. I shouldn't be standing in the pulpit. Please have somebody else preach for me, because it doesn't seem right to stand up before you and talk about being a good husband when I wasn't being a good husband. Does that make sense? And I'm still like that. I think that would be wrong. See, this is my own unforgiveness in the sense of I really struggle with people who pretend to be righteous when there's something going on in their lives. You're like, hey, what about this? I have a friend of mine in ministry who did a horrible thing, and he's still in ministry, and it bothers me every time I think about it. And it doesn't mean that God can't forgive him of it, but I'm reminded of what the Bible says. If you don't forgive others, God won't forgive you. And it's a struggle for me, because I'm like, how can you be a pastor and you can do those kinds of things? And let's be honest, if you've watched the news, there's some pastors doing some bad stuff. They have no business being in the pulpit if they're doing those kinds of things. We don't hurt the sheep. Does that make sense? If you can't get that as a pastor, you shouldn't be a pastor. They're like, well, then what about the sheep hurting the pastor? Well, that's part of the job. If they crucify you, you know you're in trouble. So the sin offering, very similar. Young bull without defect, lay hands on it. And here's what's kind of interesting. They had it prescribed for what we do for the community, or what we do for the priest, what we do for the individual. There were all these levels because Israel could do it. What if Israel sinned? What if the nation sins? What if the priest sins? There's a process by which we say, I'm sorry, again, after we discovered that we did something wrong. And sometimes we don't. I told you, I remember the time when we were church, we reserved a pavilion for a picnic. And there was a family that was using it. And I remember we ran them off. And later I'm like, why would we do that? Because we reserved it. I'll never forget, we did a concert at the Lerner. This is my own sin. And we had, it was apologetics. They sang Christian songs or Christian lyrics to secular songs. And they came to the Lerner and they did a concert. And I remember, since I put it on, I was going to sit down in like the front row and somebody took my seat. I made them move. I still regret that to this day. And then what was worse, those people ended up becoming part of our church. Like, they're sitting in the front row, I'm like, oh my goodness, those are the people that I like. Hey, get up, move. I was not nice about it. I'm just telling you, I'm a bad person. I need Jesus. I regret that. Those people ended up coming to our church, and it turns out they were horrible people. No, it's not true at all. All right. So that's the sin offering. The second is the guilt offering, and the guilt offering is different. Don't be confused. You think that the guilt offering is different. The guilt offering would be for unintentional sin against God and intentional sins against people. In other words, I meant to do it. And I like how they break it out. Unintentional sins against God. So listen to me. If you're sinning against God intentionally, I would argue that you're this big religious word. You're apostate. That means I have chosen to reject. I know the truth, and I don't care. I don't care that I hurt you. I don't care. I know that adultery is bad, but I'm going to do it anyways. I know that murder is wrong, but I'm going to murder you anyways. And I'm not just talking about in the literal sense. We can do those things in other types of ways. We can have emotional affairs. We can destroy somebody in our mind. We can destroy somebody with our words. We can gossip or talk bad about them. When we do those things that God says don't do and we don't care, I would argue that that's the picture of, you know what, God's offering you a rope and you cut it off and like, I don't care, God. And the second, he's given them an out for when they sin intentionally against each other. In other words, I'm going to steal your stuff. The Ten Commandments talk about it. Don't commit adultery. Don't murder. Don't lie. Don't covet other people's stuff. When you do those things intentionally, God's given us a way out. So there were people coming to Jerusalem, and they were offering sacrifices for those things. There was a process by which they could do that. That's how God works. He even lets us off the hook for the things that we meant to do. I'm going to stick it to Malcolm. I'm going to hurt Malcolm. I heard that Malcolm plays volleyball. I'm going to beat Malcolm in volleyball. It's not going to happen. I'm sure if we played, you would stuff me. I just heard that the other day. You're like a little stud. No? All right. It's like, where does this stuff come from? That's the things we talk to. You live in a small town, you just hear things. You go somewhere and be like, hey, by the way, Malcolm plays volleyball. All right. Kate does the flowers. All right. So, those are the sacrifices that God put in place. And all I want to say is this, because we're almost never going to take Leviticus and unpack it like this, but You need to know why God instituted these things. He didn't institute them for himself. He instituted them for us. And here we are together today. And if we could learn anything, because we're in this week where we're going to actually be thankful. And we are. We're thankful in other days than just this week. And we're thankful for all the good things. We're reflective. Thanksgiving makes us reflective. You're going to sit around your table and you're going to see your family. You're going to be like, I'm thankful for my kids and I'm thankful for my grandkids and I'm thankful for my wife and I'm thankful for this church and I'm thankful that we'll have a week that's laid back. Will some of you have like time off? Scott, will you have some time off? You need some time off? Yeah. We all need time off because we're always working. We need time to reflect. You know what work does? It doesn't make us think about the things that we have that we're so blessed to have. And we actually think that the thing that we have, the work, that's the thing that's the good thing. It's just work. Maybe our work should be being thankful. What if we lived in a world where everybody was thankful? Everybody was thankful for what they had. Everybody was thankful for the relationships that they had. What if that was the case? I'm going to have the worship team come on up. Let's end like we began. What are you thankful for? I'm thankful for my wife. Not just because I was married once before and she left me. Broke my heart. It was a nightmare. I prayed that I could find her. Lo and behold, she was praying that she could find me. And we did. I'm thankful that God heard our prayers and allowed us to do that. Now we've been married, what, 30 some odd years? 30? 30 years. What's that? No. So I'm really thankful. Somebody else? Yeah. Did you see the one this morning? It was red. But it was beautiful. Somebody else. I'm thankful that when I work out Saturday mornings with Bobby, I don't die. Yeah. Oh, that's right. That was yesterday. Oh, praise the Lord. Hey, I'm thankful. How long was our consistory meeting?
20 minutes.
Thank you, Jesus. I'm used to like 3 or 4 hour board meetings. I mean, you guys, people need to come and learn from you. Somebody else. I'm not going to sing till I hear some more thankful. What are you thankful for? What? Amen. Yeah. We had to add an electric blanket. Yeah. Somebody else. Yeah, amen. Praise the Lord. You know what? I'm thankful for Gavin and his service to our country. Amen. And it is a family. It is a family. Amen. And I live outside of Millersburg, but I love Millersburg. That's how we went and bought pizzas after the consistory meeting, Jen and I, and they were like, hey, you know Malcolm? Yeah. And that's how we learned all the... So by the way, Judd the owner of the restaurant? Is he former Amish? He said something about Whistler Mennonite. What is a Whistler Mennonite? Okay. I know it does tickle me when I drive to Napanee and they have plaid shirts and strange hats. Is that a Whistler Mennonite or is that something else? Could be. I don't know. What are you thankful for? I know you're thankful for. You do? Oh, okay. Praise the Lord. You know, I... No, I hear you. I'm the appropriate distance to my family. I'm thankful for that. Anybody else? Hey, we're all going to eat good this week, right? That's not true everywhere, right? And we're going to be warm. We're going to eat good. And I know there's like a turkey shortage, but most of us, who's having turkey? Yeah, I would have steak if we could do that. All right. God, with heart and hands and voices, who wondrous things hath done, in whom his world rejoices, who from our mother's arms hath blessed us on our way with countless gifts of love, and still is ours today. Oh, may this bounteous God through all our life be near us with ever joyful hearts and blessed peace to cheer us and keep us in his grace and guide us when perplexed, and free us from all ills in this world and the next. Praise and thanks to God the Father now be given, the Son and Him who reigns with them in highest heaven, the one eternal God, whom earth and heaven adore, for thus it was, is now, and shall be evermore. Where was the line here? Now thank we all our God with heart and hands and voices. See how the author wants us to thank God with everything that we have in all the ways that we can. God who wondrous things has done and whom his world rejoices. I don't know that that's as true as it used to be, that we rejoice in the fact of what God is doing. I pray that God would help us to be a people of thankfulness. Would you pray with me? Lord, help us to see your hand at work in our lives, in this church, and in our families. Might we see the abundance that you have provided, and may we respond appropriately. And it's not just so that we can say we love you and we thank you, but so that the world could see how grateful we are for the amazing things that you have done. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.